With the Targeted Leadership Program, we had a project to kind of investigate social media and how institutions of higher education implement social media and some of the uses that they do. And so we collected a lot of research and a lot of data and figured out some of the best ways that Northeast State could use social media on campus.
Our social media project, when I asked them and approached them about it, some people were hesitant, they hadn't even used it at all, and then other people that were already on board because they know it's up and coming and it's social media is not going away. Facebook was probably the most popular social media out there right now, with YouTube coming in second. Facebook has a diverse group of users. I'm talking from high schoolers all the way through grandmas and grandpas.
Everybody is connected with their mobile devices. This is where the students are at. They're on these social media sites. That's how they communicate. And as an institution, we need to use those tools in order to better communicate with our students. There's a lot of fear around social media. Faculty and staff here and everywhere are kind of dealing with like how to use social media, what they can do, what they can't do. So in our recommendations, we made it to where social media use was strictly voluntary.
We encouraged faculty, staff, and other departments to voluntarily use social media as they see fit. And in doing that, we created a social media web page that included all social media, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, in that, so they would have a resource at their fingertips.
Personally, I really enjoyed doing the project and getting together with the group. We had a fantastic group of people doing the research and communicating and creating our report.
I enjoy social media, so I enjoy the whole aspect of it, but the people I worked with with the social media project, they were awesome. They're really smart, intelligent people, and I did, you know, pull from their creativity as well.
Since our project was completed, we had great success with departments and individuals on campus actually implementing social media, whether it be faculty or various departments throughout the campus. We have everybody from college access programs, workforce development, etc. We have a lot of departments using social media now than previously.
The purpose of our group project was to research the feasibility of creating a diversity center at Northeast State. Creating a diversity center will create an atmosphere of support, acceptance, and respect for all. We envision a diversity center with the following goals: to educate those on our campus and surrounding communities about multicultural affairs, to recruit and retain underrepresented populations of students, faculty, and staff, and finally, to facilitate programs that promote diversity throughout our college and the surrounding communities.
A diversity center will include full-time, first-time, underrepresented groups, such as adult students, minority groups, veterans, and low-income students.
About 5% of students in higher education in the United States come from abroad. The diversity office will tend to their needs and help Northeast State attract its share of international students by offering online courses as well as on-campus enrollment.
A diversity center will focus on four essential dimensions: access and recruitment, campus climate and intergroup relations, curriculum and scholarships, and institutional effect.
A diversity center on the Northeast State campus will exhibit an intentional effort to reach marginalized populations, fulfilling our goal of access and
climate. A diversity center will be a place where students, faculty, and the community will come together to celebrate differences, our team also visited Pellissippi State Community College. We found their office to be inviting and friendly and a place where students could come together. Their office also planned and hosted an annual multicultural festival.
A diversity center enhances social development, prepares students for future careers, prepares students for work in a global society, promotes creative thinking, enhances self-awareness, and enriches multiple perspectives. We ask you to help us make Northeast State a place where everyone can feel at home.
Hi, I'm Rick Merritt along with Jim Kelly and Don Dabney, and we're here today to tell you about our Targeted Leadership Development Program project. As you can probably tell, it dealt with these chairs. Jim's going to tell us a little bit about the chairs, and Don's going to tell us about the impact of those particular chairs. And then I'm going to come back and tell you about the Cooperative Learning Classroom and some things the CTE is doing to help you use these chairs better. Jim?
Most classrooms don't allow for a lot of movement, and so as you can see here in this video, a cooperative classroom is one that is based on the idea that we can alter the classroom at will to create various learning environments, from group interaction to various ways in which the classroom can be structured, which is something that we can't do in a traditional classroom. And after we have done this, we have done a year-long study with these classrooms, and Dawn can tell us a little bit about that.
At the beginning, we only had a few demo chairs, and we put together a survey and got together some students, and, well, we tried to get some faculty, but I think most of the responses were from students, just to see what the general reaction was, had the students sit in them and then say what they liked about the chairs and how they thought they might be useful in a classroom. The first semester we had six classrooms of all over campus, the math, humanities. We had different instructors, adjunct and full-time, scheduled into classrooms and just let them use the chairs however they saw fit. At the end of the semester, we did a survey of the students and of the instructors to see what their reaction was to the chairs as opposed to the furniture that they would find in their other classrooms. And then we did the same thing again in the spring. Our spring cohort was a whole lot larger than the responses we got from the fall, and both of those were larger than the, I call them the pre-purchase surveys. But all in all, the results were generally quite similar percentage-wise. We had very positive results. The students liked them. Of course, we had the responses. When you ask anybody what they wish for, well, we had some, you know, cup holder and cushion-type responses, which are not in our, that's not under our control, but generally speaking, the chairs were a hit, especially in the classes where the instructors used them. And that was one of the things that I think we found, sort of as a side note, the students were very, very influenced by what their instructors thought. If the instructors thought the chairs were a good thing and used them as an integral part of their classes, the student responses were positive. Where the instructors tended not to use them, that was kind of obvious, and then the students weren't quite as positive about the chairs.
Thank you, Dawn. Thanks, Jim. In the fall, Dawn and I will be hosting a Cooperative Learning Foundations program. This program is through the University of Minnesota. We are both certified trainers, and we will be hosting that and we'll have more details for you later. Also, if you'd like to know more about the chairs, the survey, or anything else dealing with cooperative learning, please stop by the CTE in L204. Thanks, and have a great semester.
What we've got here is failure to communicate. Some men you just can't reach.
Anytime the question is asked, what is the major problem within an organization, lack of communication is invariably brought up. Northeast State does not suffer from a lack of communication, but rather from inefficient communication. Cohort 2's team on communication has found that any communication method that is used too much will eventually become unused. And people at Northeast State want short and to the point messages with the ability to go and find out more if they so desire. Texting from the college should be reserved for emergency only messaging to ensure that it is not overlooked or ignored. D2L should be reserved for course specific communication. A method or software needs to be found that will assist with making the college's tremendous amount of messages, announcements, and school-related information easy to produce and manage. A central repository where any announcement or news item can be found needs to be established and regularly updated. The recommendation is that we form a team of stakeholders who currently have to handle a lot of non-emergency communication to look at the way non-emergency communications are handled and streamline the process. Look at a common repository and a common format to handle web, print, digital signage, computer screensaver, audio, and text feed. Develop a opt-in methodology to prevent oversaturation of communication. Look for channeling functionality to allow messages to be sent to specific groups. Look at software systems such as Four Winds Interactive, NetPresenter, Nexcom, and so forth to determine if any will work with our current infrastructure and policies and determine if they could be cost effective. And determine the feasibility of a campus newsletter or newspaper. The Cohort 2 team on campus communication consisted of Chris Haichu, Travis Brooks, and Tom Wallace.
Did you know that approximately 1 in 5 Northeast State online students withdraw? These are students that may need the convenience and flexibility of an online class, but after getting frustrated with the technical and/or personal contact elements in a course, they decide that the hassle isn't worth it. Our project proposed to reach out to these at-risk students and provide scaffolding to help them over the barriers to online academic success. After reviewing data from various articles and presentations regarding online mentoring and academic success, and after reviewing student surveys for Northeast State Internet courses and interviewing the director for student tutoring services, the team, consisting of David Toy, Don Dabney, Robin Dice, and J. Mike Ramey, gathered to discuss approaches to online coaching. We determined to propose a part-time temporary position, which would allow data to be gathered over the space of 2 years as the online success coach developed a system to support at-risk online students. by supporting the success of online students, which would include a significant proportion of non-traditional students, this project could contribute to fulfilling the college's specific mission as well as the wider agenda of the Complete College Tennessee Act.
Welcome to the Fall 2013 Grant Development Office Update. I'm Linda Calvert, Executive Director of Grant Development, and we have with us today David Haga and Robin Bird. The Targeted Leadership Program Cohort 1 resulted in a grant development process developed specifically for Northeast State. Our initial presentation in 2012 described the newly revised grant development process, and it resulted from faculty involvement through surveys as well as our review of other community colleges and universities. While this process resulted in a reduced number of approval signatures, it did put a lot more responsibility on the grant writer. We found that regardless of the direction that you took in developing your grant, if there was a funding source available or if you had an idea, our process would allow you to develop a secure and a very succinct grant proposal. David Haga joined us in the spring in developing an access and diversity grant proposal. And we want David now to talk about his grant writing experiences as well as his working with the Grant Development Office. David?
As you know, I was pretty clueless about grant writing, and I just went and talked with you all about the ideas for the Student Needs Project. And through that conversation, we chose to pursue writing a grant for the TBR Access and Diversity Initiative. It was a new experience. The RFP, that's Request for Proposal. You simply read the RFP and do what it tells you and give them the information that you need, the writing of the grant is really not that difficult. Also, the Grant Development Office provided a lot of data and statistics to support the narrative. So really, on my part, it wasn't nearly as hard probably as it was for you and your office.
Well, thank you, David. And as a result of David's work, I believe your grant was 33,200. We requested 35,000. And for a first-time grant development project, I think that was very good. We appreciate working with you. It doesn't really matter what your proposal entails. You will eventually have to develop a budget and a budget narrative. But you don't have to do that by yourself. So I've asked Robin Bird to come in today and to share with us exactly how she can help you get over that hurdle.
Once the decision has been made to apply for a grant and you're going to make up the proposal, you do need to think about what's going to be in your budget. Along with your grant application, there are some documents that kind of tell you what can or can't be done. Mm-hmm. And after we read over those documents, we'll sit down together and kind of talk about what will need to go into your budget, what you can or can't do. And it's very important to do this as soon as possible. It's good to have an idea of what's going to go on with your budget, and it'll also help you with your budget narrative. Once your grant's awarded, if you're lucky enough to have it happen like that, then I'll help you to set up the grant and banner. We'll get the requisitions access, and you'll be able to see any kind of expenses that are going on with the grant. And if there are any kind of monthly invoices that have to go out, as well as any required closeout documents, I will handle those as well. But if you have any questions at all, don't hesitate to call.
So I think you can see that we have the grant development, grant management process covered from A to Z. During the academic year of 2012-2013, our office reviewed more than 80 different funding opportunities. We also assisted with writing and submitting almost 20 different grant proposals. For additional information or assistance, please stop by and visit us in P317, because just like the college motto, we're here to get you there. We believe in the Grant Development Office that we're here to get you the money.
This is Jim Kelly. I was really pleased to be a member of a group with Eric Morritt, Amanda Adams, Travis Brooks, Brad McKenzie, and Cindy Tosher. We formed a targeted leadership group to promote the upcoming entertainment technology program. This group planned to offer a workshop for participants who work in the field through theaters, churches, and other venues. The purpose of the workshop would be to introduce the participants to the Music Entertainment Technology Program. Our plans came to fruition on July the 23rd, 2013. Doyle Lawson volunteered to share experiences and knowledge that he had gained during his career as an International Bluegrass Hall of Fame performer. 19 participants signed up to take the Doyle Lawson Summer Music Institute. This program was 3 days in length. The first part of each day focused on a significant part of the entertainment industry. Doyle Lawson and Josh Swift, who was a member of his band Quicksilver, led the afternoon discussion sessions for each day. The first day focused on lighting, with Todd Hensley from Appalachian Lighting leading of the session. Doyle and Josh discussed the process of preparing to record music. The second day was led by Mr. Brooks, who focused on setting up sound for stage performances. The afternoon session was led by Doyle and Josh again, who extended the information that they gave the previous day with a discussion on aspects of live performance. The third day, Eric Morritt led a session on recording, which included a history of the recording industry. And it was during the afternoon session that it all came together, as the entire class participation had the opportunity to jam with Doyle and Josh.
Are you SIFT?
SIFT for day.
SIFT for business.
SIFT for evening.
SIFT for admissions.
SIFT for women.
SIFT for men.
SIFT for money.
SIFT for customer service.
SIFT for distance education.
SIFT for the front line.
SIFT for student success.
SIFT, student information at your fingertips, an Argos interface with Banner that creates awareness of the categories of student information while improving customer service. Pre- and post-test analysis of 18 staff members during a fall 2012 pilot study revealed gains in their comfort relating information from outside their departments and in their confidence of the information being correct.
Okay, Greg, just read the cue cards.
SIFT for Balding Administrator. Who wrote this?
Hello, and welcome back to another year. Our project for the targeted leadership class is something that I hope will eliminate some frustration in the classrooms. Our group consisted of myself, Vicki Crawford, and Larry Dykes. And what we came up with is something that will help you troubleshoot basic problems when something doesn't work. We all know if when you go into a room and turn things on and something isn't working, You're wasting class time, and it's very frustrating. In the past, we've been asked to put note cards or papers out on the workstations. There really isn't enough room on a note card or even an 8.5 by 11 page to tell you everything that you would need to try and make something work. So what we came up with was adapting decision tree software into a troubleshooting tool that you can use in the classroom. And this takes you just through some basic steps, nothing complicated, that you can try to get something working, because 9 times out of 10 when we go to a room, it's just something isn't switched on or an input isn't selected or something like that. And so this will guide you through the process of some basic troubleshooting to hopefully get you up and running quickly and without having to break class. Here's what we came up with. Located on the instructor's desktop in each classroom is an icon marked Multimedia System Help. Double-clicking this will open a web browser and start the troubleshooting application. The first question will always be, is the problem with sound or picture? For example, let's say that you've turned everything on and you've got your PowerPoint presentation up, but there is no picture on the screen. So you click Picture and then click Next. The next question is, what are you trying to see? The PC, the DVD player, or the document camera? In this case, you would click PC and click Next. There are even pictures to help you find what you're looking for, which devices are might need adjustment, and where they're located in the cart. The next question is that there may be a switch that should be pointing to computer if you want to see this. And then it will always ask in each step, did this fix the problem? If it doesn't, if it does not make what you want to happen, then answer no and click Next. It will proceed to another step. In some classrooms, we are now using the document camera. The new document cameras can switch the computer between the document camera and the computer. And so some classrooms are set up this way. Again, it will ask you, did this fix the problem? If your classroom is not like that or it didn't fix it, click no. Next, it will show you pictures of the remote and possibly what you might need to press. For this example, let's say that you're in one of the H building classrooms. It's an NEC remote like the one the pointer is pointing to. You click computer. You wait a few seconds to make sure the projector locks onto the signal. And let's say the image pops up. You read, did this fix the problem? In this case, yes. So you'd click yes and click next. At this point, if you want to finish, you can click the finish button and it will provide a brief summary of what you did to correct the problem. And at this point, you can either close the web browser, or if you have another problem, you can press reset and start all over again. Let's say that you're trying to play a YouTube video. Now you've got the picture showing, but there is no sound. So this time you click sound, click next. First, it will ask, do you hear anything at all? In this instance, let's say you don't hear anything. So click no and click next. It will show you where to locate the amplifier and ask, is it turned on, and is the volume turned up? Check to see if the volume is turned up, and then if you still don't hear anything, did this fix the problem? No. Click no, and click next. You'll then be presented with several steps of troubleshooting. For example, this is the speaker switch. Let's say that you look at your amplifier and the speaker switch is turned on, or it's not turned on and you press it and you don't get sound. If you still aren't getting sound, it didn't fix the problem, so click no and next. Then it will ask you to check the PC to make sure the audio is not turned down or muted. Now let's say that you try that and you still aren't hearing anything. If you click no and next, it will tell you to look at the switch to make sure that the right source is selected on the amplifier. And this really goes very quickly when you're in the classroom. You can just click through these, and if something doesn't fix something, just proceed to the next step. Now let's say you select PC, still no sound, you click no and click next. At this point, it's probably something that we need to come look at. Now during normal hours, you have a cell phone, you can call right from the classroom. The number that's provided in the paragraph at the top there is the direct dial line to the media services department. This will ring all three phones down here, someone will pick up and they can come help you. But if you're here after hours, there's a link right below here that points to the IT department help desk page. So if you click that, it will open another web browser window and allow you to fill out a trouble form. And first thing the next morning, we'll receive this and we can come take care of the issue. If you have any further questions or need further assistance, you can call me at extension 3317 or send me an email.
I'm Matt DeLozier, the Interim Vice President of Student Affairs, and I wanted to take this opportunity to introduce you to the Student Affairs Administrative Staff. Jessica Fields, Administrative Assistant. Kathy Coleman, the Dean of Student Services. Greg Walters, the Dean of Student Development. Jennifer Starling, Dean of Enrollment Management. And this is Student Amanda Broom.
And this is the Student Affairs Pace. My name is Joshua Johnson, and I'll be your host. The Student Affairs Pace will test not only the strength of your character and will, but of your mind as well. You'll be asked to navigate the Northeast State campus to see some of the offices within the Student Affairs Unit. Each office will provide you with a clue to your next destination. There are 13 clues and 12 offices to visit. Student Affairs provides the support you will need to pursue your education, but no one can do it for you. Your goal, Amanda, is to navigate these offices and find the pathway to success. Do you have what it takes to find the Student Affairs Pace?
Oh yeah.
Excellent. Here is your first clue. Good luck.
It is important to begin planning your college career early. You may want to think about where you need to apply your best efforts.
Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to the admissions office at Northeast State. Here, we help you apply for admissions, and we also help you get the required documentation that you need to be a student here, such as transcripts and chart records. Here's your next clue.
Your next stop will provide you with a guide to keep you from getting disoriented along the way.
Welcome to the Office of Enrollment Services and Campus Information. We're responsible for recruiting new students to the college. We also do new student orientation programs and coordinate the campus visit and tour program. The Campus Information Center provides a lot of information to the students, including registration, advising, and general services available. Here we have a registration guide for you, and here's your next clue.
What application has five little letters in it, but has a big impact on your wallet? The staff of this office will help you figure it out.
The Financial Aid Office is here to administer federal, state, and institutional aid to help facilitate you in your success in higher education. We also provide assistance in the Financial Aid Help Center for FAFSA. So we wish you luck, and here you go. Thanks.
If you excel as a scholar, you may want to ship yourself off to this office.
Hi, and welcome to the Office of Scholarship Programs. I'm Rima, this is Erin, and we're here to provide you with important clues on how to apply for scholarships. Your journey begins with submitting an application. Watch out for those deadlines, and remember, we're here to help you on your quest for aid.
Your next step is to find Josh near the library with information about your next clue.
Amanda, it looks like you're starting to find your stride. This is your first detour. This detour is a scavenger hunt. There are two kiosks located on opposite ends of the campus. Find one of these kiosks and you'll get your next clue.
Kiosk.
Find success when scheduling your classes by visiting the helpful staff at your next stop.
I'm not sure about your major or which classes to take? Just visit the Student Success Center and get help with career counseling, academic advising, and registration assistance. And remember, we're here to get you there.
Thank you.
If you feel overwhelmed or just need a shoulder to lean on, seek the counsel of this office.
Hi, Amanda. Welcome to Counseling Services. We're here for free short-term counseling, and we give referrals to college and community resources. Drop in anytime, and here is your next clue.
Yay!
Jobs are sometimes taken for granted, but a career is likely to keep your feet planted.
Career Services assist students and alumni in developing job search skills. We also assist in determining a major. The other thing that we do is we act as a liaison between area employers and the college. Now here is your clue, and
hotels are not the only places that make accommodations. This center does the same for its students in need.
And we are here to serve you if you have a diagnosed disability. Now, it might be medical or learning disability, or it might be a psychological disability. But whatever, we're here to help you. And we do need documentation from your doctor or a professional to bring it to us so that we can accommodate you in the classroom. We're also the liaison between Vocational Rehab and Northeast State. And I do want to give you this brochure about our services here, and here's your next clue.
Thank you.
One less than a barbershop quartet, this office provides peer tutoring that is a cut above the rest.
Well, let me tell you a little bit about TRIO. If you are serious about getting your degree or transferring to another school, then TRIO may be the program for you. We offer the support services that you would need to get through college. We have tutoring, transfer advisement, academic advisement. We do some cultural trips. We have a great tutor lab with a lot of equipment. So you might be interested in TRIO.
Yep.
There you go. Good luck, Amanda.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
College life is not just about parties and games, but this office does know all of the popular clubs.
We here in Student Life, we promote and support co-curricular campus activities and leadership opportunities to enhance your collegiate experience. Northeast State is committed to the concept of total student development. Here's some information about our organization, and this is your next clue.
Thank you.
Maintaining a healthy lifestyle may be the key to finding the right pace. This office can help nurse you back to health.
I'm Sue. This is Kim. We're both registered nurses.
Whether you have a health emergency or would like to know more about personal health, the health clinic is a good place to start. We can provide first aid and treat minor illness, also provide education and referral resources.
Kim's got your next clue. Oh, thanks.
Before you make your exit, stop by this next location to test your proficiency.
Hi, welcome to the Testing Center. This is often the first stop for college students as they begin their college career when they take Compass placement tests. It's also the last thing they do before graduating. Graduating students are required to take an exit exam. Let's get your test started.
There you go.
Congratulations, and here's your final clue.
Thank you.
You have almost found the pathway to success. Your next stop may be a good place to celebrate and make a scene.
Congratulations, Amanda. After 8 semesters, 12 office visits and student affairs, 23 classes, 67 credit hours, you've completed the student affairs pace. Successfully with the help of the Northeast State staff and the student affairs staff. But there's one more step. You've got to go across the stage. Congratulations. Congratulations.
I think faculty should participate in conserving paper for two main reasons, and I think from my perspective anyway, the most important reason is just taking care of the world in which we live and taking that seriously. That was popular for a while and kind of went out of style, you know, and a lot of us are, including myself, are kind of stuck in our ways and don't really think about it because we aren't paying for that paper. You know, I mean, I can walk in here and get as much paper as I want. So I think it's responsible of us to the natural world, but also to our institution, and ultimately to ourselves, because the promise is that this money will then be reinvested in us. Dr. Gillum has indicated that she is trying to work on the salaries and all of that, and so if we save money ourselves, if we participate in saving money for the institution, that money then can then be used to increase our salaries, which as we all know would make us very, very happy.
We started doing imaging and scanning of documents in the fall of 2011. I actually brought a file similar to what we have had in the past, and you can see the volume of paper that goes into each individual application file. We no longer are even having file folders or making file folders for new applicants. So a student comes in, they'll simply at the front counter scan the documents that we need, including a driver's license for the new requirement that they're lawfully present in the state. So they can actually just scan the driver's license and everything, and it goes into a file, a shared file that we can look at online. It has saved enormous amount of time. Customer service has improved because a student wants to know, has a transcript been received from a certain college. In the past, we'd have to walk down to the vault, look for it, hopefully it's filed alphabetically correctly, and then come out and retrieve that hard copy document and talk to the student about it. Currently, we don't have to do that at all. The student will come in or call and ask, have you received my college transcript from, say, East Tennessee State University? We're automatically able to pull that information up in our Banner student management system and see it. Tell them, yes, we've received it, and you can actually see it's a live document, and it's saved an enormous amount of time. And our vault has reduced in space. Eventually, perhaps someday, we won't even need a vault.
We're starting with scanners. Scanners have been ordered for all of our employees in human resources, and we're going to begin scanning our personnel documents into Banner. With records retention requirements, we have to keep personnel files for 75 years. So the ability to scan these documents into Banner is going to help us greatly improve our efficiency and will also help us be able to eliminate 4 to 5 large file cabinets full of paper.
It's beneficial to our department just because of the electronic. Everything's electronic now, all the documents will be electronic, and we don't have to go downstairs and pull a folder. We can actually see all the documents on site. The state auditors can see it, TBR could see our documents. Everybody would have access to our documents when we get them all scanned on. And they'll be attached to a Banner record. So that's, to me, that's the greatest thing, is just being able to have it, more people can access our information quicker.
The scanning now, everyone uses in this office. Veteran Affairs is in the office. We've recently got financial aid up and running on that, and they're doing something a little differently, and that's one thing we're going to work toward too, is when a student hands the document, whether it be an application for admission or an immunization record, we immediately scan it and then we turn around and hand it to the student. We won't keep it, and that's fantastic.
The paperless system, to me, goes in hand with the Complete College Act, and goes along with the community college consolidation and efficiency study. So it just it works perfectly with all of those plans they have in place to consolidate and with community colleges as part of the Complete College Act.
I believe the paperless workflow is important and beneficial on this campus as well as other campuses, is we're utilizing technology. We're working smarter, not harder. The information is readily available at our fingertips without having to take additional time. The process has improved our customer service base to where they get an answer very quickly rather than us having to place somebody on hold and go get the document, the original document back. So scanning and indexing has been a time saver, a money saver, and we're thrilled with it.
I think the paperless workflow initiative will aid our office in helping us to increase our efficiency and our productivity. The ability to scan documents into Banner and Compliance Assist and the addition of the People Admin online application process will just help smooth things along, help our employees to be better able to access information, will help my staff to be able to retrieve information more quickly when they need it, and it will help applicants for employment to have a smoother process when they're applying for positions here.
My name is Liz Smith. I'll be your top one teacher this semester. I brought you the syllabus and the first couple assignments with me today. I'm going to go ahead and hand those out. You guys will open to page 130. I'll go over your first assignment.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Are we doing all this?
Yes, we are.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Hi, class. This is comp one. Yeah. Did everybody have a good summer?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Good. Well, we're going to start by going over our online syllabus. Everything that you'll need for this class is going to be online. So if you forget something, you lose something, it's all there.
Everybody got time for that.
Yeah.
Out of the West, California to be exact, wrote a movement that has taken the whole world by surprise. Although Canada claims the distinction of offering the first massive open online course, the MOOC as we know it began in 2011 at Stanford University, where Professor Sebastian Thrun played host to 160,000 students from around the world via their personal internet connections. Since then, most higher education institutions have been scrambling to understand the significance of MOOCs, and many have staked a claim to their own piece of the massively open motherlode. Not to be left out, the state of Tennessee has contracted with Coursera, a major MOOC platform, on behalf of the UT and Tennessee Board of Regents sisters, each of which is producing two courses this fall. In addition, ETSU is producing two genuine MOOCs with a pathway to credit. Our team, consisting of Erica Adams, John Grubb, and J. Mike Ramey, began investigating MOOCs to determine at what level Northeast State needed to be involved in the worldwide trend. We concluded that, although the time may not be right for us to develop Northeast State MOOCs, there are two important lessons that can be gleaned and applied to all Northeast State online courses. First, the best MOOCs, like those offered by Udacity, hold an advantage over many online offerings in that they are more student-friendly and engaging. As documented in the Community of Inquiry model, for student success to take place, students need to be engaged with the course content, with the instructor, and with their fellow students, a more challenging proposition in the online environment. MOOCs can offer a platform to incorporate these elements of proven student success through increased interaction and feedback. Second, MOOCs draw on multimedia learning theory and formative assessment theory to contribute to deeper learning and mastery of foundational and introductory courses. By means of short videos coupled with brief, objective quizzes, students can build a conceptual framework that will enable a deeper level of understanding as they progress through a domain. So saddle up your horses. There are riches to be had and glory to be won from this massively open motherlode of learning gold.
When I originally suggested this particular topic to the team, I did have an ulterior motive in mind. I had just been named interim dean of the Business Technologies Division, and there is so much paperwork, information that comes across this desk. I didn't want to miss a deadline. I didn't want to miss the start that could cause a bigger problem. Maybe a student not getting a class that they needed, or even worse, maybe not getting to graduate when they wanted to. I also accepted the project leadership for basically the same reason, but I knew that it would help me to learn more about what was expected of me in this particular job. The best part of it to me was when we actually put the information together, when we made the list, when we put the time frames and all of that down. That was a tremendous help to me, and in the future, that's what I'll be checking on.
I have used the manual to try to just learn more about the tasks and responsibilities associated with my position and to get an idea of a timeline for the calendar year of when things are due. In the future, we might want to add more division-specific materials to the manual. This was really written in general for academic deans, but each division has unique qualities and unique tasks that could certainly be added to make this a more thorough document.
The mascot process took some time because most people, most colleges, already have their mascot, and no one remembers how the process went because they weren't there. They had a mascot when they started working there and went to school there. And so we really did quite a bit of research to make sure that we put all the things in place to make sure we were making the right steps at the right time to make this historical moment really work. So we formed the mascot committee, and then we offered up an online submission to where you could put in any name you wanted of what you thought our mascot should be. And we got probably 1,000 names and ideas, and some were good, some were bad, some were inappropriate. So we had all kinds of things. And so the first round was the online submission of any name that you wanted. So then the committee came together and they reduced that to the top three names that were mentioned the most. And that ended up being the Bears, the Owls, and the Jets. And from that point, our internal graphic arts designer, Jonathan Brooks, created three logos. And once he created those logos, we sent it back out to the community, everyone. We wanted everyone's input for this mascot. And when we went out with the Bears, the Jets, and the Owls, we had that final voting, and you could vote for one, and the vote ended up being the Bears.
With the Targeted Leadership Development Project, our team project was to research and develop a mascot for Northeast State Community College. And my role in that has been a bit varied, but particularly what I'm doing now is developing criteria for what that mascot will entail by way of the students who would be involved with that. And that's how we're going forward with our criteria, is to identify students to wear the suit. And in so doing, we want students who are enthusiastic, who are responsible, who are going to have good levels of spontaneity, self-discipline. There's some kind of X's and O's that we're looking to as far as what that would be across the board for students. For instance, a minimum GPA of 2.0 is going to be required.
We had to decide on whether he was male, female, color, what kind of fur, what kind of color shirt he's going to have. It's details you normally wouldn't think about. When we decided on the mascot, there was a lot of acceptance immediately. I mean, I felt like there was a need for it. There needs to be some kind of connector. And as far as marketing, it is a walking billboard.
There may not be as many projects that I'd work on while I'm at Northeast State that would be quite this unique, because once we do this, it's done. You know, I mean, I guess theoretically in the future, the mascot could be changed, but, you know, we wouldn't anticipate that would happen. So we've never had a mascot before, first time ever. And once that happens, then that's who we are.
I think a mascot really drives up school spirit, and it's also a connector for students and alumni and faculty and staff. Our mascot will have a birthday on September 10th in the auditorium, and making big plans. We're going to have all his mascot buddies from the area show up and give him some high fives.
We look forward to seeing our bear all over our community and our campus. We want students to see them. We want our community leaders to see them. We want everyone to know that our bear is now representing who we are here at Northeast State.